Live, on location, it's the Todd Alba Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Alba.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Alba, along with our outstanding producer and engineer down at the world headquarters, high atop State Street, two blocks off the Capitol Square, Mr. Aaron Sommers. We are here with Trygve Olson, senior advisor to the Lincoln Project, at our beautiful studios, WGBW, the talk of Green Bay, Wisconsin. Trygve Olson, our What Makes Wisconsin Great tour has wrapped here, or about to wrap, on a Friday. What better place to do it from Green Bay, Wisconsin?
Yep. Did you know that Green Bay was rated the number one place to raise kids?
I did not know that off the top of my head, I guess.
Yep. Maybe I can use that with the missus.
Now, Trygve,
convince her to come back to Wisconsin.
This is a great opportunity, Mr.
It's not my side of the state, but I could make it my side of the state. Could definitely live in Green Bay.
I know how much Trygve wants to get back here. And, you know, he has a lovely wife and kids out in the greater D.C. area. And his
She's probably listening.
She probably is. And that's why I'm about to say what I'm about to say. She is a very successful in her own right.
Diplomat.
She doesn't need this guy, by the way. But she's very lucky, you know, and he's lucky to have her. But here's the deal. I just want to say a shout out to your lovely wife, Erica, and your kids for, you know, kind of putting up with the slack of having you out here all week. It's really been great to have you. And so thank you to your family. I know it's been a little bit of a tough situation for them without you there. But I just want to say thank you.
Well, thank you, Todd.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
I'm sure, and honestly, Ula would be happy to come to Green Bay.
Bring her out.
She is a huge Packer fan.
Trygve is telling me stories, Sommers. And some of them, we can't necessarily use all of it on the air.
Well, she did use the F word in relation to the blocked punt against San Francisco. That was her Lambeau Field debut, and she wasn't very happy about it.
His kid is calling out plays in the stands.
Yeah, that's true.
And the guy in front of her is just like, where did she learn that? You know?
Yeah, well, like much of Wisconsin and her, she was very happy that Joe Barry is moved on to other things.
Right. Mr. Sommers, it's beautiful and sunny here in Green Bay. What is it like down at Madison today?
It's also pretty beautiful and sunny, and I have the blinds closed so I can see the screen.
Oh, very good. Nicely done. We're very excited today, not just to be in Green Bay, not just to have Trygve with us, but coming up at the bottom of the hour at 12:30, a very special guest. She is not unfamiliar to those regular viewers and listeners of Civic Media and this program and others, Dr. Kristin Lyerly. But the exciting news is she has announced this week that she will be a candidate for the congressional district being vacated by outgoing Congressman Mike Gallagher, a Republican. Dr. Lyerly runs as a Democrat here, and she's going to be here in studio. This is her home stomping grounds. We are right in the heart, Trygve, of the 8th Congressional District. Going to be great to hear from Dr. Lyerly.
It's going to be competitive. You know, the district leans a little bit to the Republican side, but there's, you know, right of center voters, left of center voters in a district like the 8th that are going to decide this. And she's a candidate who will have a lot of appeal. And I also saw the bruiser who was up here with Trump flying on the plane. He's apparently going to make an announcement on Monday. MAGA will have a candidate. Donald Trump will have a candidate in the primary.
This
might be good in the primary, maybe not so much in the general.
This is very interesting. For those, I know we have listeners all across the state. I know thanks to the Union and the Lincoln Project and Trygve, we have viewers all around, the world, but all around the United States. And if you're looking at something to watch in Wisconsin this fall, a lot has been made of the 3rd congressional race, Derek Van Orten, the Republican incumbent, who is, of course, was at the January 6th insurrection and likes to verbally abuse teenagers. I'm not making that up. That's actually real, and he does not deny that. He doesn't call it verbal abuse, but he does not deny using the F word and the S word and cussing them out. And then you got Brian Stile down there, a Paul Ryan acolyte who decided to not follow his former boss and follow the Trumpster instead. A lot of them have been made of those two races. But Trygve, I think once, and this is going to be the cool part today, A lot of our listeners know Dr. Lyerly as a great physician, OBGYN, which she is. But today I want folks to kind of hear a little bit more about her personal life, a little bit more about her views other than healthcare, although we'll talk about that.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you, to be honest, I'm excited about this because I really don't know much about her. So, yeah, you know, Wisconsin's going to be pretty lit when it comes to the presidential campaign. I was doing an interview with a television station here about our tour. And
we can say it, WISN.
WISN, yeah, the Sunday Upfront, yeah, the political.
So tune in on Sunday across Wisconsin to Upfront. You'll see Trygve talking there.
It's kind of a big deal because I deny going on television all the time.
Why do you not like going on television?
I just don't like it. I don't know.
Well, we're happy
you
like radio.
I have a face for radio, Todd.
No, you do not.
I have a face for streaming. but now I have fancy glasses that I let my 12-year-old daughter pick out. going for kind of a David Letterman vibe.
They are nice glasses.
Yes. Anyway, my 12-year-old, literally, she has style. I do not. She picked them out.
They're snazzy, as we say.
Right. But here's the thing. Wisconsin's going to be lit. You know, and I say on that show, which is what I was talking about, they were like, why are you out on the road with Civic Media, you know, and what are you doing with the Lincoln Project? And then it was funny. He's like, do you have any ties to the state? I'm like, you haven't been listening to Todd and I, clearly. But anyway, so here's the thing. Wisconsin is going to be ground zero in the presidential campaign. Yeah. We've been saying this all week. It is going to be the deciding factor, which is part of the reason why we've been out talking to regular people. You know, mm-hmm. We were at Goo's last night. We're going to be at the former Curly's Pub. I think it's 1919 now.
Yep.
At Lambeau Field tonight, 6 to 7.
7:30.
If you want to come and join us, we'll buy the first round of beers. But so you got the presidential campaign. It is going to decide the fate, I believe, of democracy in the United States. As Liz Cheney says, you know, we can afford bad policy if you're conservative with Joe Biden, but we can't afford a president who doesn't adhere to the Constitution as Donald Trump did on January 6th.
Yeah.
But it also may determine control of the U.S. House of Representatives. And as Liz Cheney has also pointed out, for those who are conservatives who are listening, given what transpired last time, you cannot afford to have Republicans in charge of the House.
Yeah.
You just can't. They cannot. When you are not adhering to the oath that you take, we take an oath. So help me God to the Constitution when you serve in the federal government. Mm-hmm. If you are not willing to adhere to that oath, then what are we as a country? And why would you support somebody who wouldn't? And I think Peter Barca, I think we'll see who comes out in the third. And I think the doctor are people who will adhere to that oath.
All right. And again, I don't want to say too much because I want people to draw your own conclusion, including you, Trygve, but I think you're going to see that Dr. Lyerly is just one of those people, as I've got to know her a little bit through Civic. She's common sense. She's just Wisconsin. And she appeals.
Right?
What?
Mark Green.
Yeah. Mike Green was
Gallagher.
That
kind of, yeah. I mean, they're serious people.
Right.
For serious times.
Exactly.
And, you know, that will be the contrast. Who is the serious candidate?
So we'll have Dr. Lyerly here coming up at 12:30. Looking forward to that.
We got to have Peter Barca on sometime.
We'd love to. We should try and have
style on.
Yeah.
I knew his grandfather.
Oh, really?
A little bit. George. Right. Was it George Stiles?
We say, look, any candidate, any politician is welcome to come on this
Even
show.
Even Derek Van Odwin.
If he wants to come on, we're happy to have him.
We'll give him one crack at telling us he was a Navy SEAL. And he clearly likes beer or brandy or something.
He likes something.
It appears.
So here is the deal, Trygve. We're here in beautiful Green Bay, and I love Green Bay. My dad's stepmom live over in Shawano, just a hop, skip, and a jump away. Spend a lot of time here in the Fox Valley.
Yep.
I love it. I love coming here to our beautiful station. But the last time I was here, actually the last two times I was here, I got a welcome letter on my windshield from the Green Bay Police Department, the parking enforcement. And yes. I had a little trouble paying. One of the tickets was like 2 weeks or 2 months old. Ooh. and it got sent. It was a big long story. I don't want to get into
fancy truck years getting towed.
Right. I had to end up going to the Wisconsin Department of Revenue here in town in order. It was a whole thing. And so people got a little, and I talked about this on the air,
And they didn't know who they were messing with. Well, you got a big
microphone. No, here's what happened.
I can see that.
Here's what happened. Some of the people, apparently staff here at the local station,
right,
started getting an inordinate amount of parking tickets after I talked about this. So we had to stop talking about it for a while.
Well, and now we may know why the mayor refused to come on.
Well, he didn't refuse.
Honestly, if I'm the mayor of Green Bay, he should want to talk to us. Well, first of all, I'm a Green Bay Packer owner,
right,
yes, along with 3/4 of the rest of the state, yeah, and probably 90% of our in-state listeners, right, and a lot of the out-state listeners.
But here,
should have come on.
Well, here's the thing. My mom, always watching out for us, our parents, she sent me a text yesterday, just a discreet text. And she says,
careful where you park.
She says, FYI, call Green Bay Police and ask where you have to all day, where you can have all day parking. You can take a cab to the station if it's too far from the station.
They do have Uber here in Green Bay.
Yes.
Well, this is a true story. So I come to Green Bay for some work related stuff. Yeah. And I needed to go over to the pro shop to get some swag for my kids. By the way, if I buy a jersey for Ula, whoever the player is, they'll be gone next year, which is an expensive thing. But
don't buy a love
jersey. So I order an Uber. And this really nice lady pulls up, and I get in her Uber, and she says, "You're my first rider."
Wow.
And I said, "Well, that's really, really cool. I'm going over to Lambeau Field. You can take me over there." She says, "Not only that, Uber just started last night at midnight here.
No.
You might be the first Uber rider in Green Bay." And so drives me over. I go into the pro shop, I come back out, and she's waiting for me.
Really? How nice.
It was. See? And I'm like, okay, there's nowhere else in America where Uber drivers are that nice.
Right?
Because the fair ended and she waited for me.
It's what makes Wisconsin great.
Yep. And she took me through I ran to Kroll's and got a burger. She waited for me there too.
Thanks for asking if I wanted one.
I know. It's so funny.
I
gave her a massive tip. This wasn't today.
Todd's
This was years ago. This was years ago.
Oh,
but
okay.
Was years ago.
There's a big.
I'm having you be my Uber to the pro shop today.
It's true. But by the way, Mom and everybody else who may be curious, here's what we did. We stayed at the lovely Hampton Inn a block and a half away last night. And I drove over. I unloaded my stuff here at the station. And I asked the Hampton people, can I bring my truck back since my friend Trygve stayed an extra night? And they said, great, sure. So I have free parking at the
Hampton.
That's
awesome. For our listeners and those streaming, particularly those maybe who are outside the state, if you come to visit the state of Wisconsin, Todd and I have discovered, don't use Amex to pick your hotel. Just stay at the Hampton Inn and Suite. Unless you're in La Crosse, because hands down, the best place to stay in La Crosse, the Radisson, where you've got Krista.
And Greg. That's right. All right, we're going to come back. A shout out to Jake last night at Goose in Stevens Point, our bartender as well. We'll come back, talk about what's going on in politics, and then Dr. Lyerly, Kristin Lyerly, candidate for the 8th Congressional District seat, joins us at 12:30. It's the All Ball Show from Green Bay on Civic Media. Welcome back to the Todd and Trygve Show, live from Green Bay, Wisconsin, WGBW, the talk of Green Bay. That's 97.9 FM in the local area, 1590 on your AM dial. Great to have you along, Trygve Olson, senior advisor to the Lincoln Project. What's up, Trygve?
I just got the funniest text.
What's up?
So somebody saw the tweet. And they're like, you should put that on a T-shirt. And I wrote them back and told them this is the truth. Because they're like, you should put it on a T-shirt. I'd like one of those. And I said, we have it on a T-shirt, but Todd only has it in triple XL, which is true.
This?
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm going to get
it. And honestly, given all the cheese curds and beer we drank this week, I'm going to be triple XL.
Yeah, me too. Me too, my friend. So, yeah, these are our great Green Bay T-shirts here. It says cheese and beer and Green Bay and radio. That's what we called it, the cheese, beer, and radio tour.
Yeah, and you know what, Todd? I just said this to you off air. The streamers heard this.
Yep.
We got to do another one of these.
Yeah,
there's
absolutely.
So many great cities to stop in Wisconsin. I don't know how many of them have Hampton Inns. And okay, for those who are listening for the first time, I'm just going to share a little story, and it's pretty self-deprecating. So Todd, I told Todd I'd take care of making reservations for hotels. And the hotel we reserved, Todd says, we'll make sure they're budget hotels. And honestly, I'm a budget hotel kind of guy. I don't know what he thought I was going to be, you know, we're going to be commuting from the Pfister every night.
You're a guy who is a world traveler and stayed at some of the finest hotels in the world. And I'm like, look, we're not paying
not
for
true.
That.
That's not true. As you found out, I don't stay in, usually. I don't even stay in Hampton Inns or Radisson's. But I booked a hotel in Stevens Point, and when we drove up to it at night, Todd and I looked at each other, and we're like, and it's late, we're tired, yep. We've been having some beer and cheese curds with our fans, and then driven an hour and a half. We looked at each other, and Todd said, I'm not parking my truck here.
Because there's no lights in the parking lot.
So one of the things that we've learned on this tour for people who are out of state, if you're visiting the state of Wisconsin, you can pretty much go to hotels in Wisconsin. You don't need a reservation,
right.
And that might be the best way to do it.
Right.
It looks so nice in the picture when the lady from American Express says, how's this? Now, I should have known a $60 a night hotel probably wasn't going to be very good, even Stevens Point.
I mean, look, it's just I like Hamptons because they're reliable, they're consistent. You get a free hot breakfast included in the deal. You can't go wrong.
No, and the one here in Green Bay is beautiful. It's right on the river.
It is. And they're a mid-priced hotel. I think that's very, you know, around.
Yeah, it was reasonable.
Yeah, right around $100 plus or minus, and $120 bucks, it's fine. So yeah,
cheaper than rent in a lot of places. You could just live in a Hampton.
You know, I lived in the Hilton in Madison for 3 months one time when I moved back to work for my former boss Dale Schultz, and my apartment wasn't done yet. Yeah. And so I did it because you get, like, if you stay 30 days in a row, you get like a lot less on rate on your taxes because you get to claim it as your residence. And I said, well, now I know how Herb Cole felt.
You probably have free hotel rooms for a year, given all the points.
I did for a while. Yeah. That was years ago.
Anyway, we digress. The other thing that we need to ask listeners is, so this time we went to universities mostly, and we're here at the station. But Todd and I were at Goose in Stevens Point. Great bar, by the way.
Great bar.
Great bar.
Shout
we were
to
in
Jake.
Some great bars, period. Yeah. Dooley's in Eau Claire is another one.
Yep.
But next time we do this, should we do it from locations like we did at Culver's and universities, or should we do 5 days of going to some of the best bars and supper clubs?
Supper clubs.
Going live from bars and supper clubs.
I think so. I would get a reputation.
Supper clubs could be good.
We'd get a reputation if we just did the show from a bar all day.
Well, and then some of not that we had any younger fans, under 21 fans show up. Well, we did have some universities. Yeah, actually. But maybe supper clubs.
Yeah, I think that's good. So many supper clubs.
Yeah, and we could have some brandy old fashions, which, incidentally, if you're in Utah or any other state, they don't have brandy old fashions.
You want to talk about your tweet with Scotty Walker last night, or should we talk about OC Eric Hovde last night?
No, let's talk about OC Eric Hovde.
All right, so OC Eric Hovde was with the Trumpster this week here in Green Bay, Wisconsin, and there is a cut we have for you all queued up from Mr. Aaron Zomers has it. Here was OC Eric Hovde being asked about the elections of 2020 this week in Green Bay.
I'm curious what you think when Trump continues to say things like the election was stolen or he won Wisconsin in 2020, but he didn't.
Look, I'm not here to litigate 2020. I'm running in 2024. I'm running for the U.S. Senate. But I do say we have to get confidence back in our election system. We can't have in 2016 Hillary Clinton saying the election was stolen, causing a $110 million investigation by Robert Mueller that went on for, two and a half years, showed that there was no, Russian interference. And then 2020, the other side loses and then saying, the election was stolen. Were there issues? Yes. But we've got to move past that. We've got to get confidence in our election process. I'm really happy that the referendums passed because that's just a step in that process.
What were the issues that you're talking about?
Well, there's many of them, Dan, if you want to talk about them. Zuckerbucks was a very concern. And if a big conservative Republican came into the state and was targeting conservative areas to push out the vote, let me tell you, liberals would be outraged by that, number one. Number two, you look at the nursing homes. Look, I do lending into the nursing home community, or used to. The average life expectancy in a nursing home is 4 to 5 months. How can you have, you know, Racine County Sheriff finding 100% of the people voting? And by the way, elderly parents are dying saying, who voted for my parent? Who did that? That's a legitimate question. You had ballot harvesting in public places. A Dane County judge said it's illegal, but the votes got counted. You had correction of votes. All those things need to be cleaned up. It's wrong. And if it was happening on the other side, people would be outraged. So let's find a system to bring everybody's confidence back into the election process.
Is your confidence back?
Look, is there concerns? Yes, of course. But, you know, again, I don't want to spend my time talking about 2020. I'm talking about 2024.
Mr. Somers, that was, well, first of all, that was Eric Hovde 48 hours after former President Trump endorsed Eric Hovde for the U.S. Senate, the California Republican now running here in Wisconsin. If you want to really, if you want to move on, Trygve Olson, I want to play this cut. If you want to really address the 2020 election and do it quick and succinct, here's how you do it. Here's former Wisconsin Republican Congressman, House Speaker Paul Ryan on the 2020 election.
President Trump lost the election. Joe Biden won the election.
Boom. That's it. That's all you have to say. But President Trump lost the election. President Biden won the election. That's all you have to say, Trygve.
Eric Hovde can go jump in a lake.
But he did.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Honestly, like that, by the end of this thing, Orange County Eric, it's going to end up being ironic because his campaign is going to start and end in the same place. Voters are going to tell that guy to go jump in the lake. And honestly, seriously, we've just been traveling the state. Every night we've been going to a great bar, meeting with listeners. We had listeners show up. We had Lincoln Project fans show up. We had a bunch of people show up. Been talking to people. We also talked to regular people in the bar, recruiting people. They're going to tell Eric Hovde to jump in a lake. That guy, you wouldn't want to have beer at Goose with that guy.
We'll talk more about Eric Hovde in the other next hour. Stay tuned next. The person you want to talk to is Dr. Kristin Lyerly from the 8th Congressional District. She's live in the studio next to the All Balls Show for Green Bay on Civic Media.
Tilted stage, the role you made me play. The fool, no, I don't like you. I don't.
Welcome back to the Todd and Trygve Show, live from Green Bay, Wisconsin, WGBW, the Talk of Green Bay. We are doing our What Makes Wisconsin Great tour. Trygve Olson, senior advisor to the Lincoln Project, joins me all week. We are here, Trygve, in Green Bay. And let me tell you, as someone who's been with Civic Media, it'll be 2 years this fall. One of the great things about Civic Media, having access to this individual, and one of the things that I think is going to make the whole state of Wisconsin and the country greater, is Dr. Kristin Lyerly. She has been a regular on Civic Media in giving healthcare advice as an OBGYN. Dr. Lyerly, welcome to the program. You had a very exciting announcement for those who might not have heard. What's up?
I'm running for the 8th Congressional District.
How about that?
Yeah.
How about that? Let's give a little cheer. There we go. That's exactly what we need. I think this is so exciting. When we heard that Mike Gallagher, you know, I thought you would have made a great candidate had Gallagher decided to run for re-election. The fact that he decided not to, and then the fact, and I'm not inside the guy's head. I don't have any evidence of this. But I think there's something to be said of the timing that he's going to resign from Congress, being the 19th of this month, means that the governor cannot call a special election, which means there won't be a tantamount incumbent going into the fall, which means that the Democratic candidate, you, has as level a playing field as we can here. And if there's ever going to be a chance for a Democrat to take this seat recently, I think this is it, and I think you're the person.
I think you're absolutely right. We see a very clear path here. This being an open seat in this cycle with abortion and reproductive health care being a big issue. And I've been very outspoken as a board-certified OBGYN doctor who works in rural areas, delivers babies, takes care of people who need birth control and all of those regular things that, you know, women need and seek health care for. This is a time where people are getting out and voting for the things that they need: health care, democracy, the ability to put food on the table. I mean, there are so many things that people are, problems that are not being solved by this do-nothing Congress. Mm-hmm. That has, it's been the least effective Congress in decades.
Yeah, I agree. When people that have listened to you on Civic Media know your background, I think it was OBGYN, but tell folks that might not have heard before a little bit about how you got into the medical field and what you do and your passion in that line.
I grew up in Kaukauna, Wisconsin, just south of where we are. I'm a proud ghost. Yeah, I grew up voting for Republicans, actually, because, you know, that's kind of the standard thing around here. There are a lot of folks who are fairly conservative. It's a fairly Catholic region. I grew up Catholic. Mm-hmm. I'm a first-generation college student. Because I had a lot of privilege, a lot of luck, I got to go to college. I got to go to medical school. I became an OBGYN doc. I've got four sons. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I love taking care of my patients. That is my passion. When I can sit in an exam room and hear someone tell me a story about a problem that they have, and often it's a really personal problem, and I have the answer, or at least I can help make it better. That is so satisfying. But right now, and especially since Dobbs, there has been so much political interference, so many barriers between me and my patients being able to access the care that they need. Not just abortion care, contraception, access to weight loss medication. I mean, you name it, they can't get health care. So because of that interference, that was really the thing that drove me to get involved in politics. I've been doing advocacy work for many, many years, but with COVID, with Dobbs, that was the end of it. I had to do more.
Trygve, we were over at Stevens Point yesterday, and we had a friend of ours, mutual friend, that said, why are there so few good people running for office? Yeah. Why aren't more business people? Why aren't more doctors? Why aren't more professionals taking the plunge and being leaders? And, you know, here we have someone who has decided to run for office.
Yeah, and I think here's the thing, and I say this about you, and I've said this about others. When you're a physician, you don't see black or white or brown. You don't see red or blue in their politics. You see somebody who needs help. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I've only had to listen to you talk for 5 minutes to recognize at the end of the day, you're running for the right reasons at a time when we have a lot of people who run for the wrong reasons. Mm-hmm. You know, Tommy Thompson gave me some of the best advice ever early in my career. Two kinds of politicians, those who want to be and those who want to do. And you're clearly one of those who wants to do things that are going to help people, because that's what you spent your career doing. And Congress needs more people like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And real folks, tell people a little bit about, if you don't mind, a little bit about your personal life and your partner, your kids, and what things. I always like to know when I vote for a candidate that, you know, I see the campaign flyer, but who are they really? So what does Kristin Lyerly, when she's not being a doctor, what does she like to do?
I'm a mom. I like to ride my bike. Mm. I hang out with my partner. He's a police officer in Green Bay. We have some really interesting conversations.
Yeah.
Yeah. My oldest son. So I first ran for office back in 2020 because of COVID. That was the first thing that when we got sent to the polls in April of 2020, and we as physicians and healthcare providers were terrified because we had to keep going to work and caring for people, but we didn't know anything about this virus. We didn't know how to protect ourselves. Mm-hmm. We knew that we were putting ourselves in harm's way, but we took an oath to take care of our patients. So we kept doing it. And so many healthcare providers died because of that, but it was our obligation. I mean, this is what we have to do for our patients. So when politicians put us in danger, that was the thing that made me run for office the first time. And my oldest son was my campaign manager. Poor kid. He was in college. And, you know, they shut everything down, so he had to come home. Right. And I'm like, well, you're not studying, so I got a job for you. And the really funny thing is now he's an adult. He's graduated. Yeah. He teaches elementary music education down in Racine with all these little kids running around, you know, making noise. And he came up. He's on spring break. He came up to help us with our big launch yesterday. And immediately he just snapped back into campaign mode, and he was helping Madeline, my manager, and helping us figure things out. He just loves it because he too, just like so many other people, Trygve, people see that what we're doing is authentic and it's for the people. And it's meant to make that positive change that people really want to see. I mean, just walking into the studio, we ran into a fellow just walking down the block, and he walked over and said, "Thank you for entering the race. Yeah. We've been watching, and I was so excited yesterday, and I'm going to vote for you, and I have friends, and I'm going to talk to them, and I'm going to volunteer. How can I sign up to volunteer?"
Wow.
I don't know who he was.
That's great.
Well, now I do. But, you know, that's the kind of energy that we're generating around here. And it's not about me. I'm just the catalyst. It is this thing that people have wanted to see.
You're roughly, I think actually you're a little bit younger than me, so we're roughly the same age. So I'm not saying this in terms of age. I'm saying this in the terms of the approach you take, because I've heard you on Pat Kreitlow's show.
I would have never guessed that. She's a lot younger than you.
I said she's younger than me.
Wait, when did you graduate from high school?
1988.
We're the same age.
Wow.
87.
Which high school?
Oh my gosh.
Kakana. Proud girl.
Oh yeah, you said that. Said Kakana. That. Yeah.
Anyway, but I've heard you talking quite
anyway.
I'm sorry that I was trying to place it.
I've heard you talking Kreitlow's show about being a mom and the fact that you've been not you're a doctor, you're OBGYN, but you've been very honest and open with your sons about, you know, sex, about their bodies, mm-hmm. about healthcare. And you remind me of my mom because mm-hmm. in the sense that she was like the cool mom that other kids would come to our house and be like, "I can't talk to this about my parents, but I have a question."
Yeah.
And, you know, she was always open about that. And I think that you represent and exemplify to me, Dr. Lyerly, what all parents need to do. And instead of hearing these things about indoctrination and about, you know, we have to be closed off on information, mm-hmm. it seems like now is the time when we have to have a situation where we're open with our kids and our young people about their bodies, about their health care, because they're human. Mm-hmm. And, you know, now's not the time to be closed off and go back 50 years, you know, when we're banning books.
We need more and better information.
Yeah,
I mean, what we're seeing now in social media, just to put my doctor hat on for a second, yeah. what we're seeing now in social media on TikTok and Instagram Reels is that there's a lot of misinformation out there about birth control and other things that people are making decisions based on a TikTok video, that if you experience an unintentional pregnancy because you're using an ineffective kind of birth control because you're told that that's the best thing, then those are huge consequences.
Yeah.
So it is so important to have good information about sexually transmitted infections and contraception and even things like exercise and diet. I mean, is the keto diet the best thing for you? Maybe, maybe not. But a lot of people think it is because it's what you're hearing on social media. I'm here to tell you it's probably not.
I mean, here's the thing. You know, you and I were kind of talking about this offline, right? So I grew up over on the other side of the state in River Falls, and I became a conservative because I didn't, in part because they raised the drinking age, and in part because I felt like as a gun owner and a hunter, the left was too busy getting in the middle of sort of my rights. And maybe I was right, maybe I was wrong about that. Now I'm a dad. I have two girls, 14 and 12, so you can about imagine. And I still consider myself pro-life, but here's the thing. I became a conservative because I didn't want government telling me what to do and being intrusive in my life. Mm-hmm. And I'll be damned if I want a bunch of theocrats getting in the middle of my daughter's life. Mm-hmm. And do I like thinking about my daughters having sex? No. Like all girl dads. I thought about that when we were doing an ultrasound in an office like yours. But I can tell you, at the same time, I'm realistic. I know that one day there's going to be a knock on my door, and me at 21 is going to show up on my own doorstep.
Yikes.
And right. I'm scared of that. But and that's a lot of people in a district like the 8th are what we at the Lincoln Project, we've done a ton of research on this, we call them Dobbs dads. Mm-hmm. Because it's antithetical to conservatism. It's antithetical to center-right values. And what I really like that I'm hearing is you're talking about these things in a serious way, in a way that from a different perspective, people like Mike Gallagher and Mark Green, who are serious people, have been talking about these. And so people need to set aside, and I think the people in the 8th District are going to do that for somebody who talks seriously about it, even if you disagree with them, because that's what makes Wisconsin great.
You're right. And I mean, let's talk about abortion for a minute, because it's hard to talk about. Yeah. As an OBGYN doctor who is very patient focused, if I could get rid of all abortions in the world, because they're hard, I would do that. But the truth of the matter is, we never will, because abortion is healthcare. And if we want to be serious about reducing the number of abortions that happen, we need to provide information. We need to provide contraception. We need to, you know, we need to make sure that people are supported, and we need to make sure that people who are having babies can raise them in an environment where they have enough resources, money, food, housing, all of those things to be able to raise them in a positive way.
Yeah.
Right. And for the conservatives who are out there listening, what I say as a dad, who do you want making the decisions for your daughters if you're a girl dad? Your daughter in conjunction with somebody like this? Or do you want Scott Walker making the decision for your daughter?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And just as, do you really want somebody on the left, Fred Risser, or I don't know who's on the left that wants to ban guns, making the decision what kind of shotgun you can have to go out and hunt ducks?
Well, and can we talk about IVF for a second?
Yeah, I really want to do that. Please, go ahead.
Yeah, because if you look
By the way, we're talking to Dr. Kristin Lyerly, a candidate for the 8th Congressional District.
Yeah, if you look at conservatives like Mike Pence or Ron Johnson, both of them have been open about Ron Johnson's grandkids were born because of IVF.
Right.
But yet, Ron Johnson is aligned with the party that would prevent people from getting access to IVF. And you really need to understand the process. Like, you're bringing together a sperm and an egg, and it's starting to multiply, and you put it in a freezer often, or maybe you're going to do a fresh transfer. But there is so much between the time that you put the sperm and the egg together and you have a baby. And I think if you are pro-life and you believe that life begins at conception, it is really hard to support the process of IVF as well. You need to understand what the weeds are.
Right. I about a minute left very quickly. We had a caller a while back that we were talking about issues and say, look, if you have a pregnancy that what's the term when it goes outside of the
ectopic.
Ectopic pregnancy, that under some of the laws that Republicans are looking at in Congress, that would be illegal. And they said, no, that can't be right. And we said, no, actually, that's true.
Oh, Todd, there was a bill in Ohio where a legislator said you have to take an ectopic and implant it in the uterus. That would be like legislated, but it's never been done. It's actually impossible to do that. Yet in politics, it could have existed in Ohio.
And see, this is what we need, I think, that we need knowledgeable doctors, women doctors, making these decisions, guiding our country. Not a veterinarian in Madison who thinks he knows, but this is true, Trygve. One of the state legislative Republicans who's a vet trying to get up and talk about this.
It's crazy. Right? I saw that.
Yeah, it's crazy. What's not crazy is Dr. Lyerly. She'll be back on the other side. Don't go anywhere. We are live from WGBW in downtown Green Bay. It's the Todd Allball Show for a Friday, TGIF on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Look what you just made me do. You don't know me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't know me.
Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Dr. Kristin Lyerly is our guest. She is a Democratic candidate for the 8th Congressional District. Aaron Zummer is our producer, engineer, knows your music.
He does. That's like my favorite song.
Nicely done, Mr. Zummer is back at the world headquarters because Aaron used to produce for Pat Kreitlow, which you were a constant and frequent guest on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we go way back.
Yeah, very good.
Well, you know, so do I. I was, Pat, if you're listening, I was in grade school when you were on WEA. Awesome.
He's going to kill you for that.
I said that the other night, and he's like, you're a liar. We were in college at Eau Claire together. I'm like, were we?
Trygve Olson, senior advisor at the Lincoln Project, is our co-host all week. We are wrapping things up on our What Makes Wisconsin Great tour at Green Bay. We are honored to have our guest this half hour, Dr. Kristin Lyerly. She is running for the 8th Congressional District. Dr. Lyerly, we know a lot about what you do as an OBGYN, but there are other health issues out there that are important to you that affect everybody in the 8th Congressional District.
I am a doctor. I take care of my patients, and I provide preventive health care. And a big part of that is making sure that people have the resources in their lives to live healthy lives. So it's not just prescribing them medication and solving their problems, but it's making sure that they have
great public education, that they've got clean water. That's a huge thing in our district, is clean, healthy water, access to healthy food, mental health services, all of those other things that we call social determinants of health in the public health field. Yeah. If you don't have those things, it is really hard to maintain your health. And all of these things are affected by the legislation that we create on a state level, on a federal level. And that's a real opportunity for me and other healthcare providers to be instrumental in creating policy that makes us healthier.
Trygve and I are both former Republicans. I left the party in 2011, Trygve shortly thereafter for our own reasons. We know how these people on the other side operate. We've got this Alex Brusewicz kid from Mar-a-Lago who shines Trump's boots. I think that's what he does down there. And he's going to announce, I think, on Monday with these MAGA Republicans. We know how these guys operate. They're going to come after. They're going to try to pull out all the stereotypes. So I want to get you on the record here. Your partner is a law enforcement officer. There's all this talk. Oh, my gosh, we get Democrats and they want to defund on the police and all this. You could speak to this personally.
We met during my assembly campaign. His daughter is an OBGYN resident. And I texted her after George Floyd happened. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, we hear all this about Black Lives Matter and we hear about what's happening with the police union, but I really want to know what's going on in Green Bay. What is it actually like to do your job? And she said, he's pretty conservative. I don't know if he'd be willing to meet with you. And I said, beer. I'm buying, and it's beer, and we'll go to his favorite place. So we had an amazing conversation, and he told me all about his job. And we found that we had so much more in common than the stuff that divides us. And, you know, when it comes to, like, he's a police officer. He's great with weapons. He is trained to use his weapon. But he also wants people to own guns responsibly, because you know what the most dangerous, scariest thing is for police officers? They have to go and check out a lot of domestic issues. Mm. And you never know. Those are always very uncertain. Some police officers were killed just recently in Minneapolis at a domestic. If somebody who shouldn't have a gun, who can't be safe with a gun, has one, it puts law enforcement in danger. And absolutely, that is something they worry about. That's something we all worry about. So, you know, responsible gun ownership is important. But for all of us, having grown up in Wisconsin, do you guys remember what it was like during deer season when you're in high school?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, hunter safety, but half the kids were gone. They were hunting.
Right. Sure, me. Yeah. Right over by Neillsville.
Yep.
Not far from where we were.
Well, your kids hunt as well. And so, yeah.
None of my kids are hunters, but one is a gun owner. He's a gun enthusiast. I think there is absolutely a way to own guns responsibly, and I support that.
And most people in the 8th Congressional District in Wisconsin are responsible.
Yes, absolutely. Agree.
They really are.
Yeah,
and there's a big difference between, you know, people who hunt, most of them are responsible and conscientious. And
one of the things
here's what I was going to say is, you know, so one of the things about the 8th is, you know, it's an expansive district, right?
Yeah.
So it's not just Green Bay. And, you know, so what are some of the challenges that you see for places like, you know, and there's some of the most beautiful parts of the states, people living up in Oconto or up along the UP. Mm-hmm. You know, what are the challenges for those people? I'm sure being in healthcare, clearly, you know, that's something you encounter people because access is an issue. But talk a little bit for how you're going to attract, you know, what would you say to those voters?
Yeah, I mean, the district includes Marinette,
right?
And Shawano and Waupaca and Niagara. I mean, it goes way up north, and like parts of Calumet County, too, which is where my family is from. Six generations. Actually, there's a town in Calumet County named after my great-great-great-grandfather.
Really?
Yeah, it's a supper club and a church and a handful of houses, Charlesburg. Right.
We're thinking about doing a supper club tour, but anyway, go ahead.
Oh, I got you. We really need to talk. Yeah.
Yeah, if you have good suggestions. In fact, anybody who's listening who has suggestions, the next tour Todd and I are going to do is 5 supper clubs across the state.
I want to be in on that. But,
yeah, there are a couple of great books about that on
yeah.
Up North
yeah,
News.
Yeah,
we had the author on, and I have those books, so I'll bring them in and we'll look at it.
All right.
All right.
Thanks, Aaron. We
Ron
appreciate that.
Paola, that's right. But you asked a question about how to reach those people. When I was working in the area, those were my patients. I worked in Oconto. I worked in Marinette. So I took care of those moms and those families, and I delivered their babies. And turns out they have the same problems as everybody else.
Yeah. Yeah. Dr. Lyerly, anything we haven't asked you today that you want to make sure that the voters of the 8th Congressional District understand about you and your race for Congress?
Yeah, I want people to know that I'm from here. You know, I mentioned I'm a sixth generation Wisconsinite. Mm-hmm. My family are dairy farmers. My dad's entire family worked at the paper mill in Kaukauna, Tilmany, depending on how you want to pronounce it. And by the way, that smell, we call it the smell of money.
And she loves the Green Bay Packers.
So. I mean, how could you not? Right. I was that little kid in the 70s, you know, during the Bart Starr era when they were not so good. Right. Yeah, but I still had my Packer jacket back
Jerry,
in the day.
Jerry Taggy.
Right.
Scott yeah. Hunter.
Well, Forrest Green.
Do you remember Vince Workman?
Oh, yes. Yes.
He wasn't very good, but they used to do the wraparound draw to Vince Workman.
Oh, really? All right.
We have a question from Andrew in Maine on YouTube. Has Dr. Lyerly stood in a frozen lake lately?
That is one thing that I will not do because I am from here and I know better.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
That's crazy.
I'm so excited for your candidacy. Trygve and I have been talking about this as we've gone around the state. And you, once you get out, right, and actually go to a bar and share a beer and some cheese curds.
Yes.
I mean, what voters want, what we've heard, is we want somebody who understands us.
Yeah.
Who's been through some tough times, who's dealt with real people, who has a real family.
Mm-hmm.
And
who will be a cheerleader.
Yes, and it will be a cheerleader.
Who wants to solve problems, not just run around tell everybody sucking on lemons and eating prunes all day, to use a Tommyism.
That's the whole job.
That's what they're all doing.
Solving problems. That's what we're supposed to be doing, right?
She is Dr. That. Kristin Lyerly. She is a problem solver, a wonderful person. I highly encourage people to get out and meet her, understand who she is, and vote for her this fall. Thank you, Dr. Lyerly. We appreciate you.
Thank you, Todd.
Always a pleasure. Come back with Hour 2 live from Green Bay on the Todd and Trygve Show on the 7th.